Tuesday practice really spirited. I mean, we're in a good, you know, a good spot, and we're in a storm of something that's tough. But, you know, and that's what Kyle Coach explained it, and he's exactly right the other day in a team meeting. But we've all been in those. You coach long enough, you know, you've been in those, and it's just how you handle them, what the process is. And, you know, good or bad, you always kind of have to stay focused and block out other stuff. And our guys are doing that really well. So I was excited about the way we've attacked these first 2 days, and we just got to keep grinding.
Is there anything in particular you've seen as kind of a response to what Coach was saying about being in the storm?
Just the guys don't get it. They don't quit. They keep fighting. They come out and fight, because a lot of times you can get in a moment where guys can start really hanging their head and really start, you know, moping or pouting, and they don't. They're just, and you shouldn't, because you can't get caught up with your next week always based on the end result of a Saturday. I mean, if you do that, you're losing touch of what the big picture, what you're trying to create, the process of culture. So that's how the guys are doing a great job. And we have incredible coaches and obviously a leader in Coach Wilcox that sets that tone. So that's why you're seeing what you're seeing when you come out to practice and you're a part of this. I'm proud to be a part of that.
Coach was saying one of the frustrating things about the turnovers is it's not just one thing, you know, that you can coach up and fix right away.
Right.
What do you guys do to try to cut back on those a little bit?
We all just have to own what we can do to clean it up. You know, that's the best way I can say it. It's like anything. If we're busy thinking the turnovers are because of that or because of that or because of that, that's the easy way out for all of us, coaches included. We all have to own, what can we do better? What can we do better up front? What can we do better at the quarterback position? What can we do better at the receiver position? What can we do better at the running back position? And ultimately, what can we do better as coaches to put them in those situations to cut down? So it's all of us owning. What can we do better to go through certain techniques and, you know, rep certain things, whatever it might be? So that's the biggest thing, because it isn't. It's not one thing. You know, it would be one thing if it was 8 fumbled snaps if you're an under center team, but it's not. It's a combination of a lot of little things. And but I think when we clean those things up, and I've been through runs like this before too, with good football teams, where all of a sudden you go into a weird turnover cycle for 5 or 6 games. You know, you've seen it with San Francisco 49ers, you know, right? You know, you go through those things, and it doesn't mean they're undisciplined or don't practice right. You sometimes go through those moments, and you got to fix them. It's not an excuse, but you also got to just believe and stay confident that we're going to get to the other side of this, and we just got to, you know, keep working on what we need to work on, and all own part, what part of it is ours.
You had some success running the 2 quarterback system mm-hmm. early with Brandon mm-hmm. emphasizing the run and Chase the pass, mm-hmm. particularly in light of all the critical turnovers mm-hmm. recently. What's the thought of not going back to something like that?
It's interesting, you know, because it all catches up, you know, because I think, here's the thing I would say. I think if 1 or 2 plays goes different in the second half of the Arizona game, and all of a sudden, you know, 1 or 2 of those plays, because Brandon was 14 of his first 18 in that game, if 1 or 2 of those plays in the third quarter goes different and we win that game by 2 or 3 scores, I think everyone's going, oh, I see why you went with Brandon the whole time.
Yeah.
You know, but it ended up not going that way, and a couple things, and they all happened quick. But we didn't want to, you know, base, okay, now we're going to flip-flop, you know, back when based off 1 or 2 things in that ball game. Because if you were, again, at halftime of that ball game, you probably wouldn't have switched them, you know, from where we were. So it's one of those things. I don't also want to just be jerk reaction because something happened in that game. We felt like where we were at that moment, that was the best thing and gives our team the best chance to win. Now we have to keep reevaluating that and going through the process. But I don't disagree with you. There are times where it was really successful, but there was times also where, you know, one guy on the field and, you know, Brandon in particular in the Arizona game was very successful as well.
Well, the Arizona game makes total sense. He put up really big mm-hmm. numbers outside of those critical turnovers. Mm-hmm. The UCLA game, it clearly wasn't working.
No.
Any but thought about making a change?
Yeah,
you
can, but I mean, we did. We thought about it a little bit, but it's one of those things where I like, you know, we were either kind of going into that game with this is the mindset and this is what we're going to do, or, you know, in terms of, you know, rotating them quite a bit, or this is the mindset, this is what we're going to do, you know, we're going to roll with this guy, because there's a lot of things happen too in practice that everyone else doesn't see. It's not just, you know, everyone sees the games, but we see and evaluate certain things in practice and decide, this is what really looks like, you know, is going to give us the best chance. And ultimately, obviously, it didn't go the way any of us would have liked in the UCLA game, but that's not also all on Brandon. You know, there's a lot of things there. The quarterback, you know, sometimes receives too much credit and too much blame, depending on whether it's good or bad, and that was a prime example.
this season, Brandon's running ability has been such a big part of your game, and against UCLA, like, he wasn't much of a factor. How do you guys kind of get him going again against Oregon?
Yeah, it was. I mean, there were just certain looks they were giving us that weren't the same as some of the other looks, and other things presented themselves. And, you know, like I said, unfortunately, we weren't able to hit on some of those things. But it'll again, you got to still take it when it's there. I mean, you want to, you know, push the envelope with it, because it has been a big part of it, but you also don't want to force it if it's not there. So, and if they are taking that aspect away, then other things should be open, and we just got to be cleaner, you know, in those areas when we have the opportunity to hit other things, you know, in terms of certain RPO things and certain receivers that get one-on-one opportunities because they are maybe overplaying Brandon in the run game.
What prompted you to move to the booth last week, and what did you think of that vantage point?
It was good. I mean, you know, part of the reason, you know, coming down when I first got here is it was what I was used to. It was what I was used to, you know, calling plays for so many years on the sideline as a head coach. So it was just kind of, it made sense. It was the comfort area. But as I did it more, and especially this year, I had thought about it a few games back. You know, I thought, you know, could it be a chance to improve? Could it be a chance to improve in terms of seeing certain things? Could it be a chance to, you know, sometimes get away from a little bit more noise and everything that's happening and just see things better? And also, you know, develop such a good connection and trust with all our assistants. I know, you know, I 100% understand what message they're delivering to the guys on the field. So it felt like the right thing to do. And I actually, 100%, I loved it. You know, obviously the end result of the game wasn't what we wanted, but in terms of everything about it, yeah. And, you know, if it's up to me, I'll continue to do that. I think it is definitely something that is beneficial.
How would you kind of evaluate what the offensive line was able or not able to do against UCLA?
Oh, I thought they did some, you know, good things. I mean, the game was kind of a strange game, you know, because we had, what, less than 30 snaps in the first half. So sometimes it's tough, and all of a sudden, you know, had a – you know, a couple balls, you know, hit the turf that could have been big plays. And then obviously, you know, a turnover. And before you knew it, it was halftime. You know, we were attempting a field goal right before half. So I thought they were doing some really good things early, you know, and different guys. We just were, you know, we were a play or two away. And after you don't get the ball first, sometimes your possessions in the first half are less. Now we came out the second half and they did a great job. You know, we kind of didn't do anything spectacular, but just marched down the field to start the second half, which they did a great job at that. And late in the game, you know, for all of us, we weren't at our very best, but sometimes that can be tough too when all of a sudden a team gets a two or a three score lead and they're able to pin their ears back, they're able to understand, and then it becomes, you know, a 2-minute type drill every play, which can be a real challenge when you get into, you know, pass mode, unless it's something you just do all the time, like a WSU or someone like that. But for us, we're very much, you know, RPO and running the ball. So when we get in that moment, that puts those guys in the toughest spot. So I thought they did a lot of good things. I mean, obviously we all have things to correct, but when you look at it again in the last three games, last game a little bit, it wasn't as good, but in the others, it's not a lack of moving the ball. It's a lack of finishing drives in the red zone, and obviously it's the major is taking care of the football more than anything else.
Is there anything you do differently to reassess how you're coaching as an offensive staff during the week after a loss like that?
You do. You just try and put them in more stressful situations. You continue to work on the things that are your weaknesses, you know, which right now a weakness for us is certain things in the drop back pass game aren't where they need to be. So we work on those things and we put them in those stressful moments. Certain things, obviously, with our ball security are not where they need to be. So you put them in those moments and you put them through, you know, more of those drills and just, you know, work on focusing on that stuff and those aspects. But that's the best thing you can do, you know, is put them through the moments that are the weaknesses. I mean, just kind of like today when they had the music blaring, you know, a little bit louder and that sort of thing. We need to put ourselves in that moment when we go on the road, you know, to just put us in more of that mindset of what it's going to feel like in that stadium, not being able to communicate very easily and just make it more stressful during practice, you know, so the game doesn't feel stressful when those moments come up.
Hawkins got a little bit more playing time. Mm-hmm. Because of the absence of others, or does he figure more in the game?
I think he just figures more, you know. I mean, obviously, Jordan Duncan being out, you know, it's you know, all the receivers are going to have to, you know, continue to pick up their game and pick up number of reps. But I think Jeremiah is a guy that, you know, regardless of injury or anything else to other players, you'll continue, as long as he keeps working and on the, you know, progression he's on, you're going to continue to see him a little bit more the rest of the season.
What does he bring to maybe the others don't?
He's one of the burstier guys. I mean, he's got some serious burst that way. He's got some run after the catch ability. He's versatile in that he almost has some running back stuff to him when he gets him on either, you know, whether it be a swing, whether it be a bubble, whether it be some sort of quick screen, you know, different things like that, that you can just do some versatile things with him laterally that it comes natural for him.
Use some explosive plays.
100%. We absolutely could. I agree.
Malik's a guy that good things have happened a lot of times when he's been on the field. It seems like he hasn't gotten as many reps lately. Is there any thought process behind that?
Oh, yeah. I mean, he's, you know, and he's going to, he probably would have, you know, you look at last week, he had 17 reps. He probably would have been in the 25 or 30 rep range last week had it been a more balanced game. But when you get it to a spot where you're down playing catch up, that's not really going to be, you know, getting into four wide and things like that, that's not going to be where he plays as much. So yeah, even last week there was a plan probably to be more in that range. And, you know, you could see it, you know, increase as we go along. But obviously we're a different team, too, in terms of certain guys tight end-wise than we were a year ago. So it is. They all understand that, you know, their role might not be as big as it would be if it was only one or two of them. But we just got to, you know, take on the role we're in. And excel. If it's 17 plays, if it's 19 plays, if it's 20 plays, whoever that is, you know, take advantage of those and make sure we're doing that at a high level rather than 30 or 35 plays at not the level that we need to win.
You were talking to the guys about explosives yesterday, and they were talking about, you know, sometimes it's breaking a tackle or beating somebody one-on-one. But is there anything as a coach you can do to kind of create opportunities for chunk plays?
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, but at the end of the day, you hit it on the head. You know, no matter what you create, someone's going to be covering them. Someone's going to be coming to tackle them. You know, at the end of the day, that's what it comes down to. I mean, occasionally you can get a, you know, certain gadgets and certain things like that, like we tried to do with Pat, and then their corner actually sank underneath it. So twice now we've run toss pass and we've checked it down, which is, I've never done that twice in a year. But occasionally, you know, get some of those. But for the most part, you look around the country, watch any chunk play, most of the time it's winning. It's winning in a one-on-one situation. I mean, and that's even on, you know, on all of Brandon's. It's not like those were just, you know, magical plays. Those were him breaking a tackle or winning in a situation. That's why he has a lot of, you know, explosive and chunk plays. He's got speed and strength and does that. So that's what it comes down to at the end of the day. And you know, and I think we'll get to that level. And I think Pat hit it yesterday too. If we can take care of the football and be on the field more and get in a rhythm, those things will come too, because then you get them run, and then your play action off of that. You know, and things like that can happen, just like possibly the second play of the game could have possibly been an explosive, you know, depending on how that far. But you got to just develop that sort of rhythm, convert third downs, take care of the ball, and then you'll have more opportunity for explosives as you go.
I've seen you work in Christopher Brown earlier and more often here. What have you thought of him kind of in his freshman year here?
Doing a great job. I mean, and you see it on special teams too. He, you know, last week was his most reps, obviously, offensively, and for good reason. He practiced, he earned them. But he's been, you know, kind of being a factor on special teams all year, which has been huge for us. So he's slowly but surely, you know, putting himself in a spot and, you know, playing ball like a veteran. You know, that's how he attacks it. That's how he approaches it. And, you know, he's physical like a veteran too. I mean, he doesn't look like a true freshman when he's walking around or carrying the ball. So, love having Chris.
Thanks.
All right. Thanks, thank you. Appreciate it. See you guys.